back to AA Lessons Online. All right, we are back with our part 9A on macroeconomics. We're going to be looking at inflation today. So in the previous two parts, okay, your part 8A and 8B, I've already covered what you need to know for economic growth. So things like actual growth, potential growth, what are the causes and the consequences, okay, of undesirable rates of growth. So in this part, we're going to be looking at inflation. Okay, it's a bit of a more slightly challenging part, okay, but it's definitely very, very fun, in my opinion at least. Okay, it's very, very fun to do. So go ahead and make sure you do stay tuned for this entire video. And this is just going to be the first part, okay, of our two-part inflation series. The next part, I'll be looking at what are the consequences, okay, that inflation can actually bring about. So in this part, let's go through the causes. Very, very simple. There are just two main causes that we're going to be going through. All right. The first things first, we need to go through what the definition of inflation is first. So inflation is defined, okay, as the sustained increase in the GPL, the general price level, which is your y-axis, okay, your GPL, okay, I can't really write it in a highlighter, okay, of an economy. So it's measured using this thing called the consumer price index, okay. This is just for general knowledge, you don't actually have to know this. It's otherwise known as CPI. It basically aims to measure the average price, okay, of a fixed basket of goods and services, okay, that actually increases over time in an economy. So there are two main causes, like I've mentioned. Okay, the first one is demand pull and cost push. Okay, so you just have to remember your ADAS, right? So demand pull is usually always going to be caused by AD, and your cost push is going to be caused by your supply side factors, which is going to be your AS. Right. So what is the demand pull inflation all about? Okay, so demand pull inflation, the by the book definition, okay, it is very simply caused by a high AD, okay, given the constraints of AS. Okay, so when AD actually increases, while AS either remains the same or increases at a slower rate. So the main assumption, okay, that you have to always take into account is that the economy has to be producing near or at full employment. Right, we'll see in the diagram later why this is so. So an example of a paragraph, okay, or a causal link, okay, that you can use to explain demand pull inflation is with a rise in consumer spending or export earnings. So these are factors of AD, right? There will be a rise in AD. So assuming, okay, that the economy is operating at full employment, okay, a rise in the general price level will definitely be to a greater extent. Okay, we'll see later on why. And no increase, okay, in real national income will actually be seen. Right, you will see this in the diagram later, okay? So hence, the rise in general price level results in this thing known as demand pull inflation. So as long as there's an increase, okay, a huge increase, especially in your general price level, okay, likelihood, okay, that inflation is actually taking place. So if you look at it in the diagram, okay, this is an example of your demand pull inflation. So we're going to be looking at when AD2 shifts to AD3, okay? This is where it's closer to or at full employment. So as you realize, right, when it moves from AD2, okay, AD2, your national income is at Y2, your price level is at P2, okay, your general price level, correct? So when it actually increases, okay, from AD2 to AD3, okay, as a result of, let's say, an increase in any of your AD factors, your increase in C, increase in I, increase in G, or increase in your net exports, it will actually cause the price level to increase up here with a smaller rise in your national output. So as a result, this increase in your general price level from P2 to P3, this is what we call demand pull inflation. On the other hand, your national output does not actually increase as much. It can still increase, okay, but it's definitely to a smaller extent as compared to the rise in your price level. Right, so that's how the diagram looks like. Okay, next one we have is cost push inflation. So this is when an increase in cost of production for reasons not associated with AD actually happens. So every time there is an increase in cost of production at full employment, an increase in any of your AS related factors, sorry. So things like an increase in cost of production whereby your AD actually remains the same or does not actually change as much, okay, it could even shift downwards, okay, this will actually cause cost push inflation to happen, okay. Remember, when you're looking at cost push inflation and demand pull inflation, you always want to hold the opposite factor constant, okay, which means that for demand pull inflation, we would try and hold AS constant. For cost push inflation, you want to hold AD constant. So an increase in cost of production, it will raise the total cost, hence resulting in a fall of profits. Hence, the firms will need to cut back on production. Okay, so when firms cut back on production, it means that there will be a fall in your national output naturally. Okay, and this will lead to a fall in AS and a rise in your general price level, assuming that AD remains unchanged. Okay, hence the rise in GPL and hence cost push inflation. So our main assumption for cost push inflation is always that the change in AS is independent of AD. So whatever it is, the assumption for cost push inflation is that our AD is going to be constant. There's no changes in AD at all. Okay, so some reasons for cost push inflation could be also due to rising labor costs. So this can be caused by an increase in wages more than your productivity increases. Okay, this will actually cause your overall labor cost to increase, right? Because the output that's coming out is going to be lesser, okay, than the amount that you're actually paying all this output, okay, your labor. Okay, a rise in the cost of imported raw materials, okay, this is also known as this thing called imported inflation, okay, which can be caused by inflation in other countries due to a fall in domestic exchange rate. So when other countries actually reduce, okay, their exchange rate, okay, that means they depreciate. Okay, we'll learn more about this later on. Okay, but let's say if they depreciate, what happens is that there will be a change in the value of net exports and imports. Okay, the rise, there will be a rise, okay, in their prices of exports, hence a rise in your price, that means your own country's prices of imports. Okay, that's why there is this thing called imported inflation, right? If you're still unsure on this part, not to worry. I'll go through exchange rate very, very soon, so just wait for that part, okay? But essentially, just understand that there's this thing called imported inflation, okay, which can be derived, okay, as a result of other countries' fluctuations, okay, in exchange rate. Alright, so this is how cost push inflation looks like. Okay, it's looking at when the curve shifts from AS to AS1. So what happens is that at the original curve, okay, remember AD remains constant. At the original curve AS, okay, your input or your output, sorry, is at Y, national output, and your price level, your GPL, is at P. Right, but what happens is that, let's say, due to an increase in labor cost, okay, or an increase in your cost of production due to increasing prices in terms of your raw materials, your curve will actually shift towards AS1, right? It shifts inwards and leftwards. So what happens is that this will cause your output to fall naturally, and an increase in your price level from P to P1. So this is what happens, okay, when you have cost push inflation. Alright, your curves will actually shift. Alright, so last part, okay, is this concept that you just need to understand, okay, or at least it's good to know. Okay, it's not a huge part, okay, but it's definitely very, very crucial in terms of ensuring that you understand what this is. It's known as an inflationary spiral. Okay, this will act more as a good evaluation when it comes to essay writing. Okay, if inflationary spiral, okay, it essentially refers to a continuous rise, okay, in prices that is sustained by the tendency of wage increases and cost increases. What happens here is that an initial demand pull inflation, okay, may actually strengthen the bargaining power of strong trade unions and drive up the wage costs. Right, and this will cause cost push inflation to occur. Hence, the prices will carry on rising, and this will cause an inflationary spiral. So what actually inflationary spiral is all about is that there is basically an initial rise in your demand pull inflation, which can be caused by an increase in AD. So this will cause your demand pull inflation to occur. And as a result of the demand pull inflation actually occurring, okay, this can actually strengthen the power of trade unions. Okay, what trade unions do is they can actually help to bargain for increased wages. Okay, that means they can help. They're basically a union. So what happens is that the people, okay, will go to all these trade unions, and then everyone wants to fight for greater wages. So this can actually cause increased pressure on wages. So if your increase in wages is more than your increase in your productivity, this will cause an increase in cost of production, hence an increase in cost push inflation. So just take note, okay, that what happens here is that when there is demand pull inflation, okay, naturally your prices are already rising. Okay, so if your prices are rising, definitely people, in order to ensure that they still have a decent purchasing power and a decent disposable income, they will start to fight. Okay, fight for an increase in their income, okay, an increase in their wages. So this fighting for increase in wages through the trade unions will cause the pressure, okay, on wages to actually increase. So when the pressure increases, okay, if your wages increases more than the productivity, okay, it will cause an increase in your cost push inflation, an increase in your cost of production, hence an increase in your cost push inflation. So just need to take note of this part, okay? It's not always tested, but it's good to know that there's this thing called an inflationary spiral, basically when there is both a rise in AD as well as a rise in terms of your cost of production, okay, which causes a fall in AS. So what happens is that over here, there's basically a rise in AD combined with a fall in AS. Right? So this is what inflationary spiral is all about. So when it comes to your exam requirements, okay, very simply for this first part, you just need to be able to explain the the causes of inflation. Okay, be able to recognize the underlying factors that may bring about this demand pull inflation and cost push inflation. So things like your AD factors, okay, your consumption, investment, government spending, net exports, right, increase in X and then a fall in M. Okay, these can all cause a rise in AD, which can cause demand pull inflation. On the other hand, cost push inflation can be caused by an increase in wages, increase in labor costs, increase in your cost of production, increase in your imported raw materials that will cause your cost of production to increase. Okay, after that, you just need to explain and discuss the consequences of inflation in relation to the causes. Okay, this will be in the next part. And lastly, explain the causes of deflation. Okay, these are all basically the opposite of deflation. Okay, when the economy is operating below full employment, and what happens is that there is a greater fall. The economy is operating near full employment, okay, and there's a greater fall in your general price level, okay, when there's a fall in AD, and cost push inflation would just be the opposite, okay, for deflation as well, okay, when there is a fall, okay, in your cost of production, okay, it can cause deflation to occur, right? Usually that is not really a huge factor, it's more of your AD factors that will be more prominent. Alright, so go ahead and make sure that you understand what the main causes of inflation are, right? Just keep it very, very simple. Understand what demand pull inflation is, that it basically is an increase in AD with no changes in AS, and cost push inflation, that is a fall in AS, okay, or an increase in your cost of production, okay, as that is not affected, okay, by AD related factors. Alright, so that's all for this video. Okay, I hope you did learn something. If you have any questions, you can always leave in the comment section below. I will answer them. If not, do be sure to give it a like as well as subscribe to the channel. It doesn't cost anything. It's free and you can always change your mind later. So if not, I will see you guys in the next part on part 9B, okay, when we're looking at inflation consequences. So for this part, inflation causes, make sure you master it. It's the easiest marks to actually secure when it comes to your macro econs, right? So make sure you really go and understand what the different causes of inflation are, get your causal links right, and you should be set and good to go, right? If not, I'll see you guys in the next one. Have a good one. Bye-bye.